Today we have lecture of HCI Human Computer Interaction. I am Sumaira Hussain and today's topic is human memory. Before starting our lecture, let me tell you why we are studying this topic. Because the subject is concerned with humans and computers, and the aim of the course is to improvise or to improve the interaction or the communication between humans and computers. So, in order to improvise it or in order to raise the level of interaction between both of them, we need to understand first how humans and how computers operate, how they are structured, what is their functionality, vice versa. That's why today we start from human memory and we will study about humans, how the human memory works, what is the structure of the human memory, and many more. Our topics for today's lectures are memory first and then its types, then sensory memory, short-term memory, long-term memory, and the two more concepts associated with the long-term memory, that is recall and recognition. What memory itself is? The memory is basically the large repository in a human mind that stores data, facts, rules, and also a processor that associates and find out the relation between the objects and the facts. You can see the memory model on screen. Basically, our memory structure starts from sensory memory. We all are composed of senses. And how many senses we have?
Five,
obviously. And what are they? We use most of them in interactions, most of them. Here we are targeting three main sensors that are used to store things in your memory. I'll talk it on later that how they are working, but for now our memory first is part, that is sensory memory, is composed of or that relies on iconic memory, that is basically your ability to see things, echoic memory that relies on your ability of hearing, and haptic memory that relies on the ability to experience, to feel things. Then this memory shift towards short-term memory, and how the things shift to short-term memory is dependent on how much attention we pay to them. The more your attention to you pay towards any objects or any concept, any information, the more the things get stored in your short-term memory. Although the time span for both type of these memories is very short. Then moving on to the largest part of the memory, the largest storage, that is long-term memory. And we train our memory to store things. How we do this, we'll talk about it later. Have you ever played a game when somebody asks you to tell that how much things you have seen in your journey from home to university, or the list of items you bought from the market? Anyone? Never. Okay. Let's do it today. Can you remember or can you spot out the things that you have seen today traveling from your home towards your university, reaching here?
Vehicles.
Sorry?
Vehicles.
Vehicles and?
Shops.
Shops.
Fixed camp near Mali.
Schools. Okay. Anything else? Have you seen all these things for the first time?
No.
All of them?
No.
Is there any one thing that you have seen for the first time?
Yes, ma'am.
People.
Faces. How many faces you remember? Are you able to identify any of the face if it comes back again in front of you? Does anybody tell me how this happens? How can you identify things or relate things?
These are
heading in front of us. Basically, in our daily routines, we see so many things, and all these things are stored somewhere in memory just because of the practice, because of the habit that we are doing it repeatedly. The storing the process of storing is basically recognizing the facts and associating them with each other, finding out the relation between different facts. That's how your memory starts storing things. That's the procedure. You learn things. Starting from our first type, that is sensory memory. Sensory memory acts as a buffer for stimuli received through the senses. As I told you already, it is composed of, or it is divided into further more three parts, that is iconic memory, echoic memory and haptic memory. Iconic memory relies on your visuals, your visual stimuli. How does it work? Whenever you see a thing, your sensory memory stores that image for few seconds, that is around 0.5 seconds, half of a second, and then that image vanishes. Have you ever seen fireworks? What happens when we see them? Sparkles. And when you shift your eye towards another view, then what do you see? Or let's suppose you see the sun and then you are looking at different direction. Are you able to see the clear vision?
No.
For a little time, and then it will get clear. It is because of the image that is created on your memory, on your buffer. That image remains for half a second, and after half a second that image vanishes. If you continuously see the thing, that image moves from sensory memory to short-term memory. As I told you already, that things from sensory memory to short-term memory travels by the attention you pay to them. Another one is echoic memory, that is basically oral stimuli. That is dependent on your ears. Let's suppose you are in a hospital or you are standing on a bus stand where there is so much noise, and all of a sudden your friend comes and calls you. Are you able to hear his or her voice? Almost. If you are not paying attention or you are sleepy little bit and I just call your name, what would be your reaction?
Active,
shocking. Because still when you are sleeping, your ears are active. And the voice that come in your ears move towards your brain through neurons. That is all the time active. Although there is a little delay in it, the time for the oral memory to stay in your sensory memory is basically 4 seconds, not more than that. Oral memory resides for a longer span as compared to the iconic memory. There comes a haptic memory. Haptic memory is the information that can be recalled from the sense of touch. Things you can feel by your hands, by any part of your body. That is basically a tactile stimuli. Sensory memory collects all these things and store it in the memory. Let's start with a little test. Look on the screen. What was written there? I want you to tell me in exact order what was written there. CTA and? Okay, you are saying the first one is CTA. Then? MWK. And the last one? EX? Y. Let's see how many of you are oh, it's perfect. How did it happen? Because when I was talking to you, I have changed the slide and your attention diverts toward it. You have seen it, your memory take an images and store it in the buffer. After half a second, I have asked you what was written on the screen. Exactly. Everybody told me the answer. But when after 1 hour, I will ask the same question and you are not able to answer what was there. It is because the image vanishes, it is not stored, or we haven't trained our memory, we haven't paid any much attention to it, that's why the picture goes. Moving on to the haptic memory, I need volunteers, 2 volunteers. Yes, one more please. Anyone? Both of them will read or pronounce few words for you and you have to guess what they have said. Anyone please, Fahim. 4 times.
Bar, 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 bar.
Thank you, Fahim. What did he said?
Bar.
Bar. Fine. 2 times, 2 times. Far, far, far,
far. Far,
far. Far, far, war.
Yes, thank you, Danish. Far, far.
Far, far.
Far, far. Danish has made things easy for you because he have placed the pauses and put so much stress on war that you are easily identified. But most of the times when same type of words with the same phonemes or same speech sounds, you are unable to identify what the one is saying. But here, how you identify these words is because you have heard these words so many times in your life, you are familiar with it, these are not new words, and when that person calls that word, your memory, you recall your memory and you find out what he is saying, associated with the voice or the with the pronunciations. Last is for haptic memory. I need your cell phones, at least 3 to 4. Thank you. Remember which one is yours. Anyone who wants to perform the test? Umair, why don't you? I am placing them here. Close your eyes, just touch and find out which one is yours. Done? I'll change the order. Close your eyes.
Like my hand?
Please.
This one?
Yes, 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 yes.
That's it.
Pick it up. Thank you very much. Yes. Umair used to carry his cell phone in his hands most of the time, but still he was not able to identify it when his eyes were closed because he was not ready for the test. If I have told him earlier that I would do the same practice with him, then the results would be different because things change when you pay attention to them. Your focus changes. Let's suppose you are in your room and light goes. Is it able for, you are able to come out of your room without touching walls and other things?
No.
Not exactly. And if the same scenario is here, even if I allow you to touch the things and then move out, how many of you think that you can do it in a quick moment? Most of us can, because our hands are basically our senses that touches the place, identifies it, where it leads to. And the second sense that we are relying on with touch memory is our ears. When your eyes are closed, you use your ears and your touch sense to identify where you are, where you want to go. When your eyes are open, your touch sensor is not very active as compared to the iconic memory or the echoic memory. But haptic memory helps you to identify things when you are unable to see them, even though you can find out the things by touching them. When your mobile phone is placed nearby you and you are looking at TV, you can easily find it out. without turning your face towards it. Moving on to short term memory. The sensory memory moves information from that sensory to short term memory by paying attention, as I told you. Short term memory, as named short term memory, that means for small time, but larger than sensory memory. The time of access for short term memory is 70 milliseconds and the decay rate is 200 milliseconds. That means, do we remember earlier or do we forget things early? We forget early. Basically, short term memory has a limited capacity. There are two methods for its measurement. First involves the length of the sequence and the second one involves the order or the structure. We memorize things in little chunks. That chunk size is 7 plus 2 or 7 minus 2. That is Miller's rule. Miller says that being humans, we memorize things in short term memory. Either it is in the piece of 5 or either it is the piece of 9. Whether it's number, whether it's sentence, the structure makes it easy for you to memorize things. What does mean by structure? Let me explain you with an example. I am writing few letters, sorry, numbers here. I want you to look at it. What was it?
49.
What was it? Almost lost the pace. Why? Because numbers are many. Now you are unable to memorize it. The reason, you can't find any pattern in it. Instead of that, if I would write it in that way, what was it? Now it's easy to remember just because I have made a similar pattern. Pattern related to telephone numbers, exactly. And it is divided into 7 and 3 codes. The first piece is basically 3 or 4 and the second piece is basically 9 to 11. It changes. How many of you remember your NIC number? Very good. Anyone likes to tell it? Have you noticed the pattern? How we tell it? 4-2-2-0-1, then a pause, then that 8 digit and last digit. So you train your short term memory in piece of chunks, little chunks. That size is probably of 5 or of 9. Let's take another test, this time on sentence, sorry, word. Very good. Perfect. Notice the time you take to solve it. The first one, very fast. Second, pace little goes down. And now, spectacular. Spectacular is difficult one as compared to the first two because the size or the length of the word is more than 9. So you need time to identify it. You need to recall your memory to find it out where that information lies, compare it and then give the results. Same as our PCs do. So moving on to long term memory. How you train your long term memory? The information shifts from short term memory to long term memory by rehearsal. I said that information shifts from sensory memory to short term memory just by paying attention. You pay attention and things goes on. But in case of LTM, it doesn't work in that way. You have to rehearsal lot of times to memorize things. Our long-term memory has a slow access, as mentioned here, 1 by 10 seconds. But its decay rate is also very slow. You don't forget things on very fast pace. Its capacity is unlimited, although your memory, the information that is residing in your memory, keeps on changing. We will talk it on it. Basically, LTM has two types. The first one is called episodic memory, and the second one is called semantic memory. Episodic memory is constructed by the experiences or the series of events in the time or in serial form that you have experienced in your life. Whereas semantic memory is the structured memory of facts, rules, concepts, skills that you have learned by practicing. You have achieved these skills with some effort. I have mentioned two examples here for the episodic memory. The first time you travel by airplane or by train or by bus, the first time you travel, you will remember that experience from start towards end, each and every information that has seen through your eyes, that has gone through your eyes. In the semantic memory, knowing that cricket is a game, it's a kind of semantic memory. How do you know it? You watch cricket, you play cricket, it is classified in game that has been taught in your early classes, or somebody has told you that cricket is a game, that's why you know that cricket is a game. Basically, the semantic memory comes from episodic memory. First you learn from your episodic memory, and then it will convert it into semantic memory. Because in episodic memory, you learn the things from your surroundings, from the events that have gone through your life, and then your memory extracts the facts and the information that has been seen in the episodic memory and stores in somewhere in the repository. That becomes the semantic memory, that is called the fact or the structure memory. In the case of semantic memory, you need to structure it. What is mean by structuring? Relating things like who is your father, what is the name of your grandfather, who was your grandmother, who is your sister, who is your brother. All these relations are related to each other. That is a basic structure that is created in your mind, and you can find it out. If there is an aunt from your paternal side, from your father's side, you can easily identify it, the relation with it. All these things are part of your learning, your skills. Moving on to the retrieval. I have told you that information gets stored in the memory, but how you access that information? There are basically two mechanisms for it. Number one is called recall. Number two, recognition. Recall says that information can be retrieved for LTM by the cues, the hints. I'll tell you how. Whereas recognition says that information that is presented in front of you gives you the knowledge that you have seen it before, sometime before. For example, login. You all have some account on Gmail, Yahoo, Outlook, LMS, many accounts. Whenever you log in to the form, you need two things to log in. The first one is your ID and the second one is your password. I am saying that you are recalling your information or your password or your ID. Basically, the page that is in front of you itself is a queue, the interface. Because all these interfaces are different from each other, or they have their specific logo that creates a picture in your mind that we are talking about Gmail, or we are talking about Yahoo Mail, or we are talking about Outlook, anything like that. Then whenever you enter your ID, you have a specific password for it. Most of the time we create passwords making with some associations so that we can remember it. Like someone create passwords with the type of account they are making. Let's suppose in my case, for Gmail account, I created password with my phone number and combination of someone from my family name. In the case of Yahoo, because it's a good practice to keep different passwords for different interfaces, I have changed the mechanism and now phone number is replaced has been replaced by my car number. Some people also related with the interface and use their specific words or logos as their password also. So they can easily memorize it. If sometimes you forget your password, we use hints to find it out. And seeing just one letter or just one number, you re-memorize it what it was. That is called recall. In case of recognition, it's not like that. Let's suppose you have an example of a menu system. Let's take an example of a word processor where there are number of menus there. And you want to draw a square on it. How would you find it? Even if you don't know where it resides, you will explore the menu and whenever you find the same shape, you will simply identify it. That will work for me. So, recognition basically makes a comparison with the interface that what is linked with it. When I am saying square, there is a specific shape in my mind and whenever I see that picture or that shape, my mind calls me that this is the one I want, even though I don't know the name of the menu item. That's how recognition works. So, here we end today. That's a quick summary. What we have studied is memory. The memory is then classified into three types: short term, sensory and long term. Sensory memory itself is divided into three parts or three different types of memory or three different senses, that is iconic based on your visual senses, echoic that is based on your oral senses, haptic that is based on your tactile senses. Short term memory related to or dependent on semantic memory, because you learn things from semantic memory and that goes in your short term memory by paying just attention to them. Therefore, the train goes on and we move towards long term memory from short term memory. Here we have to rehearsal, we have to practice it to learn things like you learn your syllabus. Long term memory itself is classified into episodic and semantic memory. Memory that is based on events and memory that is based on some facts presented in front of you, hence that is. That's the end here. Thank you very much.